Hello and welcome to The Quest on Rajya Sabha TV. I'm Rakhee, Bakshee. In this show, as you know, that each week we bring you a leading personality, a personality through which we try to understand what's happening around us in our society. And through them, we not only hear his or her story, but also the vision that the person has to share with all of us. And also very, very special guest with us on this show on Rajya Sabha TV. And the person is the chief whip of his party, that's BJD. And his name is Mr. Tathagata Satpathy. He's a Lok Sabha MP from Odisha. I welcome you on the show, on the Quest.
Thank you.
So as we are now finishing this particular session of the Parliament, what have we gained exactly? It's been a budget session, very important and crucial for everyone. So how do we really look at it?
First of all, you said the party's name in, you know, with just the letters. It is Biju Janata Dal, because a lot of people misunderstand and they think the D is actually P. So we are D, first. Secondly, this country puts too much stress on the budget, which I personally feel that it has become more or less of an exercise which has not really that much of a far-reaching effect. Because whatever we hear in the budget being spelt out doesn't really sink in to the people's level, to the grassroots level, within 365 days.
Somebody would say it's practical.
What is practical?
So, for example, not really, and as let's say the vision of the leaders would say that not really, you know, catering to the demands as such and to, you know, as somebody would sometimes say that budgets become populist, but really looking at it very logically to give each segment its due.
See, budget, what I find over the past 15, 16 years that I have been seeing this, is that it is more of a document which spells out how the government is focusing its energies, its resources, and where does it want to take the country. But in reality, the money being apportioned off, let us say, for agriculture, you have 5,500 crores being given for insurance, farm insurance. Whether it is insurance for the farmer for his life or whether it is crop insurance. And if you see the past couple of years, the amount has not really increased, which implies that this year also, the amount that has been given is primarily to just hold on to what was there last year or the year before that or the year before that. You are not increasing your spread. Similarly, that 82,000 or 85,000 crores that has been supposedly given as subsidy for fertilizers. Now, the whole world is moving away from chemical fertilizers. We are not giving this money to the farmers. We are giving this money to the fertilizer manufacturing companies.
You see, are you hinting at not giving again the due to the right people who really deserve it, but to giving a segment that...
Yes. Absolutely. See, these what has happened is over a period of the last 2-3 decades, we have more or less meticulously, assiduously killed all the government companies that were manufacturing chemical fertilizers. Now, most of the major players in this country are private players. So, you are giving a huge, big amount as fertilizer subsidy to these companies, and they are supposed to pass on that benefit to the farmer.
What about
My take is, why not say that this money we will not give to the fertilizer companies, we will withdraw all the subsidies, and instead, whatever money we have, we will give it to the farmer as an increased MSP.
So don't you think when we talk about consensus, I think all these suggestions and views, I would suppose and I would think should be taken care of when one really looks at such an important document, which is about India's whole economic frame and structure. But social sector, MGNREGA, are you happy with it, the kind of allocation?
Well, it's very similar or a marginal increase. But again, you see, how does it get implemented is the problem. You may have very flowery looking, very attractive looking programs here at Delhi level. The union government is not the implementing agency. That is where a lot of people misunderstand. And the state is where implementation is
done.
Delhi is supposed to formulate policies. When people scream at us, that you are disruptionist, you are not letting the parliament function.
True, and you talked about it all in the parliament also.
You have to debate, you have to shout, you have to, suppose a wrong thing comes up in the instance of the Aadhaar card.
Mm-hmm.
I personally have many reservations. Why would you want to know my biological details? Why would you want my organs to be scanned? What, finally, who's going to access all those data?
Mm-hmm.
So when the government would
contend that it is doing so, for other reasons, could have what security implications.
No, they are spelling out the reason. They are saying that we are doing Aadhaar primarily to ensure that the deliverables, that means the benefit that the government is giving to the poor, are actually delivered. So if that be the case, why don't you strengthen the BPL card? If that be the case, why don't you strengthen your election ID card? Why don't you strengthen your ration card? There are already a plethora of cards of identification systems in place.
Mm-hmm.
You strengthen the existing ones.
So as a parliamentarian, are you also saying, and through us, that the government is somewhere failing
yes,
to look be pro-poor, which is one of its mandate, to look at India's challenges and the crucial challenges, as we know, are of health, education and how to eradicate poverty?
See, poor, that word has also got perverted. Anybody living in a village, anybody who is into farming, the Delhi mindset is he is poor. I believe a farmer is not poor. A farmer is producing something without which you or I cannot survive. All the intelligentsia, the so-called English-speaking riff-raff of this country, survive because they get food in their stomach. Where does the food come from? So if we do not recognize the basic necessities of life. Air conditioner is not my necessity. I can survive without air conditioning. I can survive without petroleum. I can survive without a car or an aircraft flight. But can I survive without food and water? I cannot.
So how? Let's look at a larger kind of framework. How happy or satisfied or dissatisfied are you with the current discourse? Because when you talked about all this in your speech, which emanated out of one particular university that one was looking at, JNU in this case, but about the kind of society we are living in, about the kind of atmosphere we are living in.
We are living, in my opinion, again, this is a very personal thing, we are living in a society which is getting more and more fractured and splintered, and we are all trying to move away from each other. The rich are purposefully trying to move away from the so-called poor. The so-called poor do not have the facilities to be closer to the rich.
Hmm.
So we are creating a bigger divide, which I fear may create immense social pressure and may damage our social structure further in a foreseeable future, not in a long future like 100 years or 50 years. It's not like we read about the Mughal era or the British era.
Hmm.
It might be something in the lifetime of people living today.
But you, how do you look at this contradiction? In your speech, you talked about democracy that we are all proud of. And the same democracy then tells us all to have freedom of speech and expression. And at the same time, right now, what we are witnessing is a huge debate on these things itself. How would you really look at it?
See, democracy gives you freedom. You should know how to use freedom. You should be enabled to respect freedom also. Freedom means if I have the freedom to walk, I also should be conscious that you too have the freedom to walk. I should not step on your toes. That is respecting each other's freedom. Unless we start to learn that,
mm-hmm.
this freedom has, it is endangered. It will eventually be taken away from us by anybody. And there is this slogan now, less government, more governance. Mm. I, for one, totally disagree with that.
Okay.
I think there should be less governance, more of government. Because government for me means an effective judiciary, an honest and effective policing system.
True.
Suppose I want a ration card or an Aadhaar card or something, I should be able to get it instantly. The babu at the desk should not be able to stop me. That is government for me. Governance is when through the Aadhaar card or through so many other means, you want to pry into my private life.
That's how you look at governance. I mean, that's a very, very, I would say, interesting dimension to how
that is governance.
One would look at governance.
Who wants governance? Who wants to be controlled at every step? Nobody wants that. So governance is that. So when they are saying more of governance, less of government, that's a very wrong thing. Government should be bigger, should be stronger, should be more honest, and you spend enough for government. There is no harm.
So do you think when you talk about the government that the task it has to actually do good for the people,
yes,
and as a state do good for its citizens, do you think at a time when we in the parliament and outside also, when we take up issues which are a little beyond what should be really discussed, how would you really look at that? Do you think we are not addressing the right things at the right time, at the right forum?
We may be addressing the right things at the right time. This forum is to address everything. But there should be more tolerance on both sides. For instance...
So, word which has really been talked about much, you've heard that, tolerance.
Yes. See, tolerance, I am not talking about communal tolerance or just religious tolerance. Mm. For that, I do not believe I am a secular person. I am an irreligious person. I don't believe in any gods, goddesses in an incarnate form. I believe in divinity, but no, that is another aspect. I'm not getting into that. What I'm trying to say is that suppose a bill is brought into the House and other members, maybe of the Treasury benches, but mostly of the non-Treasury benches, give amendments. Our system has become such that the government side considers that if an amendment is passed, it is an affront. It is a defeat for the government. So come what may, even if it's a good amendment, we are going to say no. So the no's have it and the no's have it.
I know.
Why are we negative? Why can't we accept an amendment? Why can't we break out of that format that, okay, fine, we accept your...
But that's not a new phenomenon. How would you really look at that as an aberration in the current times? It's been happening where you
have... That's what I'm saying. That's what I'm saying. So a nation as a being or as a... as a concept, gets these opportunities once in a while when people veer away. Like in 2014, people veered away from a bunch of people who were in power, in the seats of power for a long period, for about a decade, because they thought these are people who do not mean well to the country. So in that mood, people veered away towards somebody or something
they
else.
They looked up to that time.
Not really appreciating this, but because there was
finding
no other
an alternative, you're saying. So
yes,
we'll talk about that alternative, whether it has worked and in what manner, if not or yes. We'll take a look at all these different angles and dimensions. But we are taking a very short break right now here on The Quest on Rajya Sabha TV. We are, as you know, talking to Mr. Tathagata Satpathy. A very interesting conversation going on right now here. Don't go away. We are going to really talk about many important things here on the show. Welcome back to the show. You're watching The Quest here on Rajya Sabha TV and I'm right now talking to Mr. Tathagata Satpathy. But some critical questions now. As your party and your member of Biju Janata Dal, I must say for the benefit of
the
audience also.
Thank you for not mixing us up with...
And one should not. But so where does the party stand in the sense we have seen, you refer to...
In the question of Bharat Mata Ki Jai.
2014 you refer to, and I'll take my context from there. Then, as a party, where do you belong in the sense, are you trying to create, when we talk about a front, part of a front, whether you are with
we
a certain...
We are the front. What do you mean by we'll create? We are the front.
In what
we
sense?
Are, if you watch the Biju Janata Dal MPs, we are the most sensiblest, if there is such a word in English, most sensible group of people. We talk sense.
Yeah.
We try to be... honest to our work.
But which side are you on? I mean...
Why should we be on any side? There's stupidity on one side, foolhardiness on the other. Which side would you like to be on?
So one of your leaders, I think, referred to that, saying that extremism on both sides.
Yes.
I mean, referring to left and right.
Yes.
So, but then what is BJD for us?
BJD,
let's understand.
BJD is pro-India. We do not believe in Hindustan. We believe in India. We believe in the concept of the motherland.
Mm-hmm.
We do not have to say how I love my mother is my problem. I do not have to say Bharat Mata Ki Jai to prove that I am an Indian, I am a Hindu. I don't have to prove anything like that. I don't have to say Bharat Mata Ki Jai to say that I am a Hindu, I am a Brahmin. This, that, all that is not necessary.
So be more active. Why a sense of ambivalence sometimes that we see where all these...
We are not ambivalent at all. We have very clear views on virtually everything. Today, one of our honorable MPs took part in the Pathankot thing. He spoke about the past, how the Congress has had miserable failures and by its inept and mishandling encouraged terrorism in this country. And we also talked about how inept the present clan is, how the NSA, whoever, some Doval or somebody, how he has failed and how he's an inappropriate person in a very powerful seat.
So let me be here for once on part of the government. I would say somebody, let's say even Prime Minister Modi wants to reach out, as he says, and he says, by disturbing me, you're disturbing maybe the idea of development and growth. So
that's
let's walk together.
What all these people think. They do not realize that the beauty of democracy is change. Nobody is permanent. I am not permanent as the member of Parliament Lok Sabha from Dhenkanal in Odisha. Tomorrow, somebody else will come. Yesterday, somebody else was there. Once we accept that we are not permanent, then we will start thinking about the country. Our problem is we are thinking we are
Is there
everybody.
A sense of opportunism that we should see being silent and tacit in understanding with sometimes certain parties and not according to what suits?
There is opportunism everywhere. That is what you see. It is in business, in politics, in administration, everywhere. And even in government, you think bureaucrats will let a government function if it doesn't kowtow to their wishes? No. The government is bureaucrats. Politicians come and go. They are just jokers on the surface. But it's actually the bureaucrats who are handling everything. And I have said this over and over again. And that is what we are all playing into their hands.
So how are you really becoming an important part, as I would repeat my question, the current discourse in terms of really changing them?
By being
the
a sane voice. By being a sensible voice, we are trying to be a part in nation building. We don't have to take sides. We are trying to carve a middle path. We are, our leader Naveen Patnaik ji, he says, keep equidistance from both sides, because both are abhorrent to us.
And you have been always saying you are against corruption. But yes. let's talk within Odisha. Let's go to Odisha and say that, are there not problems? We have seen problems in the case
everywhere.
Of mining. We've seen some rift within the party. We've seen certain cases of corruption also.
But you know something? The Odisha government was the first state government long before this Shah Commission was instituted. Not the emergency wala Shah Commission. This Mining Wala Shah Commission, and its ambivalent, its, you know, confused report came out. Our government, Naveen Patnaik's government, had stopped and curtailed mining, illegal mining, in a major part of Odisha. So it is not that I am standing up for the bureaucrat at the ground level, the mines inspector, who is obviously, he gets triple his salary as Bakshish from the miner. So he just closes his eyes, whether it is 10 trucks of iron ore going out or 100 trucks going out, he doesn't bother. So at that level, there has to be a change of mindset. And people like you can, help in creating that change.
We are, through our medium, of course, trying to do that. But let's look at bills, for example. And when you look at legislation, somebody would say, let's all work together. Let's say GST, something that has been, we have been talking each session that comes, we've been talking about it. And certain other important legislations which really keep pending and which are very, very important. I'm glad that real estate bill one talked about and finally has seen the light of the day. But look at GST.
Well, what is the real estate bill if you go deep inside? Does it deal with the problem of water scarcity? How will these multi-storied buildings have sufficient water? Most of our urban local bodies do not know the difference between sewerage and sewage. They think it's all the same thing. So wherever your storm water goes through, your toilet water also goes through the same pipeline.
Okay. So you find lacuna there as well?
Yes. The bills are drafted haphazardly. Some Babu has drafted it. And politicians stand up to defend as if it is their life.
What about GST? I mean, would you say it's a Babu vision?
I have my doubts about GST also. Although my party, my government in the state, my leader's government in the state supports GST. We support because we are a consuming state. So we are supporting because there will be temporary benefits to us. But in the long term, people, once they are spoon-fed, they don't want to become independent. So consuming states may benefit now, but in the long term, they will never become producing states. Then what happens? So GST will be a deterrent to make consuming states turn them into producing states. So you will have a bulk of the country dependent and a few states producing.
Why don't you really strengthen the federal structure that we should believe in, and actually, and let both state and center really come together when we talk again about walking our own talk of growth and development?
We haven't done that. The Congress messed up over the past half a century by considering any state government that was non-Congress to be an enemy. And that mindset has continued till now.
Mm-hmm. So where do you see the difference and where do you be the difference? That's my question.
We are trying to be an active partner in breaking that mindset that nobody is nobody's enemy. Mm-hmm. Everybody is an Indian.
We have some elections coming in, for example, assembly election. There would be very, very important issues. When we look at Punjab, we will be looking at drug issues, which is really a great menace. We'll be looking at some of the crucial issues in West Bengal, Assam, Tamil Nadu and Kerala. How are you looking at, and not really segment-wise, state-wise, but really holistically when we are choosing and electing the right kind of candidates, the right kind of leadership?
I trust people. I trust the Indian, average Indian voter is much smarter than all politicians rolled together.
Mm-hmm.
And the innate sense of wisdom and foresight is there in the voter.
Mm-hmm.
So all these news, you know, all these TV channel people who say that people make mistakes and, you know, that's all humbug. People never commit mistakes. It is we, the elected representatives, who lose sight of our commitments, not commitments that I'll do this or I'll get your son a job. Those are not valid anymore in today's world. You promise that to your voter, he doesn't vote for you.
So here I have to really take a little bit of personal twist to it and saying that, Mr. Tathagata Satpathy, have you been a rebel? Have you been blunt enough? You've been asking people to ask you direct questions. How would you really we look at you?
Look at me like a human being. I'm trying to be as human and as normal as possible. Never let ego and conceit get into my head, because once when I was an MLA in 1990 during Biju Patnaik's chief ministership, when I faced the next election, I lost in 1995. And then I looked at myself. Was it my workers who failed me? Was it shortage of money? Mm. Was it my other, you know, my vehicles or something? No, I found that it is me, the conceit, the ego, that feeling that I, me, mine, that actually destroyed me. So I realized that if we can shed that, we can shed a lot of baggage.
Yeah.
And this is not a spiritual sermon I'm giving, but I have practically worked it out in my political life, and I'm at peace with myself.
You are at peace with yourself, but how much are you peace with what's happening again around, which emanated out of, and I don't really want to give that much space also to what emanated out of JNU phenomena, but also to other universities, student politics, as to whether there should be more debate or whether more silence is needed, or whether
there
a balance
should always be. I am somebody who supports debate, but I am saying that, you know, like this boy who was heading JNU at that time, everybody glorified him. I have seen so many left party student leaders who give equal speeches and that sort of fiery attitude, and then later on you see that they get mellowed down.
She's saying he's one off.
Yeah, he's just one off. Why do people get so bothered? That's what I'm saying. If he's saying something, let him say. See, for the past 2 years, I do not support Afzal Guru. What I'm saying is, for the past 2 years also, they had been celebrating this Afzal Guru hanging day. Why didn't anybody react? Just because a certain students group had no entry into JNU, they did not react.
So do you think we are deviating? There are cases of corruption. For example, we are still trying to find Vijay Mallya. So there are issues of importance that we should address. There is black money issue. There are issues which really confront and face common people and about their lives. Do you think we are deviating somewhere from the real issues and that we should tackle?
We are deviating in Vijay Mallya's issues also. In Vijay Mallya's issue, I think his calendars and his airline and all his, you know, pomp and glory actually made bigger problems for him. But poor fellow, what NPS has he created? There are so many others who are controlling this government of the day with 1 lakh crore NPA in their personal or in their company's accounts. Those people are scot-free. So we are not dealing with everybody as equals. We should. You know, okay. Anybody who has created NPAs and who has looted public money should be punished. Why only Vijay Mallya? I am seeing line all of them.
Mm-hmm. So, as we are trying to wrap up broader questions of, as you said, right to equality, right to freedom, right to justice, as far as even women are concerned in India, what's your take?
I've seen Indira Gandhi. I have seen many strong bureaucrats women. Who are women bureaucrats. Yeah. I will not say that women can help other women get emancipation, social emancipation. The emancipation proclamation has to come from within first. Mm. Secondly, if you want women to be free, it has to be done economically, give them economic freedom.
That's a valid point, yeah.
And women should not beg men for equality. You cannot say, give us reservation, we want to get into parliament. It's only a
So, you're against reservation, you're saying?
Sorry?
You're against reservation of women in
parliament? I'm against all kinds of reservation.
Mm-hmm.
Because even if you take caste-based reservation, in the past 70 years, it is the same family, same people who are getting the benefits. And if you have heard the speeches yesterday in Lok Sabha, many of the honorable speakers said, don't allow new people to enter. That means safeguard my reservation. For me, don't allow others. Mm-hmm. I believe there should be newer people coming in under reservation. Older people should be phased out.
Okay, that's a good take on reservation. And I think we'll have to really wrap it all up here. But very, very brief one line on what's your quest, Mr. Tathagata Satpathy, that you're here on this show.
My quest is I would love to see India and the youth of India as really being modern, free, not only in clothes and cars and, you know, goods, but mentally, spiritually, they should be modern and they should be free.
What a vision that you shared with us here on our show on Rajya Sabha TV. Thank you so much for coming
here,
Rajya, and sharing all those thoughts and insights with us on this show. And that was Mr. Tathagata Satpathy, MP from Lok Sabha, who shared with us his vision, also talked about what's really, really facing us as far as our country is concerned. So thanks a lot for watching this particular edition of The Quest on Rajya Sabha TV. Namaskar and bye-bye.